The next speech is Seerat of Hadhrat Raeesuddin Khan Sahab, a companion of Prophet Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, and the speaker is Musawwir Mohammad Sahab.
Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa tahu la sharika lahu wa ashhadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu amma ba'du fa'uzu billahi minash shaitanir rajim bismillahir rahmanir rahim was-sabiqun as-sabiqun ulaikal muqarrabun fi jannatin na'im tullatun minal awwalin wa qalilun minal akhirin. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, dear guests of the Promised Messiah. First, I think I need to address two questions. Who was Hazrat Raeesuddin Khan Sahib, radiyallahu anhu, and why am I up here speaking about him? Well, he was one of the two Sahaba of the area called East Bengal, which is now known as Bangladesh, and that is where I come from. So that's my claim to fame. We're also very lucky that in the LA Jama'at we have a lot of members from the Ahmadiyya community from Bangladesh, and so I'm deeply grateful for the organizers to ask me to present. I think obviously my gratitude to the organizers for affording me this opportunity to address you on this topic. Undoubtedly I feel honored to be speaking about the Sahaba of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam from the region of Bengal. However, I will take this opportunity today not only to talk about Hazrat Raeesuddin Khan Sahib, who is in the title of the speech, but of two others who also have a claim to honor from the same time and from the same area. So the translation of the verses I've just recited for you as follows. They're from Surah Al-Waqiyah, chapter 56, verses 11 through 15. The foremost, they are the foremost. They will have achieved nearness to God. They will be in gardens of bliss, a large party from among the early believers, and a few from the later ones. The verses of Surah Al-Waqiyah that I've recited reference believers from the later period or Al-Akhirin. There are more commonly referenced surahs such as Surah Al-Jummah. However, Surah Al-Waqiyah talks of three groups of people who come after a prophet. Those on the left hand, how unlucky are those on the left hand. It talks of those on the right hand, how lucky are those on the right hand. And finally, it talks of those who are the foremost. They have referenced a large party from among the early believers and a few from the later ones, i.e. from the time of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam. Only Allah knows best, but surely the Sahaba have the greatest claim to be amongst the foremost. A few more comments to anchor us before I introduce the life of the Sahaba of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam. The companions of the prophets that Allah describes in the Holy Quran as stars. So we are reminded that the stories of the Holy Quran are not just tales of the ancient. Rather, through them are unlocked the very mysteries of our creation and purpose of our life on earth. Likewise, we should not take the recounting of the life of the Sahaba as stories from the past, but to remind us of the greatest miracle that Allah refers to again and again in the Quran. And what is that miracle? It is the miracle of the giving of spiritual life to the dead. How many a verse have we read in the Quran that speaks to the miracle of the rain that falls on the barren land and with it brings forth the bounteous herbage and flowers? That is the same miracle wrote with the coming of a prophet in those followers who drink deeply at the fountain of their righteousness and knowledge. Khalifa Rabi Rahimahullah reminded us that the recounting of miracles is to strengthen the belief of the believers. It is not for those who do not believe. So likewise, the recounting of the life of a Sahaba is to relish in the miracle of one who came to life at the hand of a prophet. And for us, it is to be reinvigorated and reminded of our faith and belief in the unseen. I have taken this detour prior to getting started, as I thought it would be useful, particularly for the younger members, if not for all, to establish the relevance and importance of recounting the life and history around the Sahaba of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam. While there is rich history on the Sahaba who lived in Qadian, or spent much time there. The records for the first Sahaba of East Bengal are far more sketchy due to the fact that A, that there were only two Sahaba from Bengal, B, they only remained in Qadian for a short period of time, and C, the Anjuman Ahmadiyya in Bengal was formed many years after their bayat. And as a consequence, much of the history was not recorded. Given this backdrop, what I'm about to share today is as much about Hazrat Raeesuddin Khan Sahab, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, as it is about the miracle of the birth of Ahmadiyyat some 1500 miles from Qadian in a place called Bengal, a glorious example of the fulfillment of the revelation vouchsafed to the promised Messiah Islam, that I will surely cause thy message to reach the corners of the earth. Indeed, in one of his, historical sermons, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Sani mentioned that after Punjab province in India, the country in which Islam's influence was most widely spread was Bengal. As I mentioned in the history of Ahmadiyyat, we find that there were two learned people from the then East Bengal who came to Qadian and took bayat at the hands of the promised Messiah alayhi salam. They are one, Maulvi Ahmad Kabir Noor Muhammad radhiyallahu ta'ala anhu of village Batali of Chittagong district, which is in the southeast of Bangladesh. And second is Maulvi Raeesuddin Khan Sahib of Najagon village in Kishorganj district, which is in the northeast of Bangladesh. However, before going into details about them, I'd like to mention a third very important individual of Bengal. This third very renowned person was a peer of Brahman Birya. His name was Maulana Abdul Wahid, who during 1903 corresponded through letters with the promised Messiah Islam and asked many questions to him. The promised Messiah Islam answered his questions, and to the good fortune of the future generations of Ahmadis of Bengal and elsewhere, he preserved those questions and answers in his book, Brahin Ahmadiyya, Volume 5. Maulana Abdul Wahid's research and investigations on the truth of the promised Messiah Islam continued even after the death of the promised Messiah Islam in 1908. Towards the end of 1911, Maulana Abdul Wahid decided to go to Qadian and see for himself how the lives of the disciples of the promised Messiah were transformed after taking bayat. Since he himself was a prominent scholar and studied in the madrasa of Maulana Abdul Hay Lokhani, he thought of meeting and exchanging ideas with some of the India's learned scholars of Islam on his journey to Qadian. On his way, he met Maulana Abdul Reza Khan Berelvi, Maulana Shibli Nomani, and Maulana Abdullah Tonki. None of them could put forth any valid arguments against the reasoning and claim of the promised Messiah of Islam. Rather, he found them deceptive and holding grudges not based on taqwa or fear of God. Frustrated with them, he reached Patala, the last railway station before Qadian, and there he met Maulvi Muhammad Hussain Batali, the famous Ali Hadith stalwart. After some failed arguments, Maulvi Batali tried to persuade Maulvi Abdul Wahid Sahib not to go to Qadian, because whatever Mirza was, now that he is dead, there is no use going there. But with profound wisdom and surely a reflection of the state of his mind, Maulana Abdul Wahid replied that if a fire had been lighted there, he would surely be able to find its remain in the form of ashes. After reaching Qadian, he went straight to meet Hazrat Hakim Maulvi Nuruddin Khalifatul Masih I, radiallahu anhu, who was at that time taking a Darsul Quran session. He was stunned by the new insight and brilliant explanations of the Holy Quran put forward by Khalifatul Masih I. After attending these sessions for a few days, he found that all his personal vanity on his own depth of knowledge stood nowhere compared to this treasure of knowledge. He had to acknowledge that this knowledge could not have come out of simple human endeavor. Rather, it must have descended from above through revelation. He finally took bayat at the hands of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih I, radhiyallahu anhu, in December 1912 and came back to Bengal. He was given the authority to take bayat, and so the people of Bengal could come and take bayat at his hands. He was also made the emir of the then Bengal. Hundreds of his disciples in Brahman Birya entered Ahmadiyyat at his hands soon after his return, and many local Jama'ats were established. Although Maulvi Abdul Wahid Sayyid was unable to take bayat at the hands of the promised Messiah Islam, and thus cannot be given the title of a Sahaba, yet he was the first person of the then Bengal to correspond with the promised Messiah Islam, and thus is just as important an individual in the history of Ahmadiyyat in the then Bengal, now known as Bangladesh. Now I will come to the first of the two Sahabas of Bengal whose name I mentioned earlier. His name was Mulana Abdul Kabir Nur Muhammad Razilatana Anha from Chittagong district. A famous Mohsin Awliya or saintly person came from Yemen and first spread Islam to this part of Bengal. Mulana Kabir Nur Sahab was an 8th generation descendant from Mohsin Awliya's nephew, Shah Sikandar, who had also come with him from Yemen. Mulana Kabir Nur Sahab received his highest education from Darul Ulum of India and received in-depth religious knowledge. He was a learned alim on Islamic teachings in light of the Holy Quran and Hadith. He would counsel and advise people to turn their attention to God. People were drawn to him because of his recitation of the Holy Quran and his melodious voice. Thus he was recognized as a respectable religious character in society. He was aware of the fact that Mujaddid appeared at the turn of every century. So when he heard that Hazrat Masih Maud al-Islam claimed to be the Mujaddid who was to appear at the beginning of the 14th century, he started to think deeply and seek guidance through prayers, and look how miraculously his prayers were answered. For he left the Bengal and went to Rangoon in Myanmar or Burma. And there he started a trading business, but his health deteriorated, and on the advice of a doctor, he was told to go to Uttar Pradesh in northern India. On his way to Uttar Pradesh, he stopped in Delhi for some time. The promised Messiah and Imam Mahdi, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadian alayhi salam, was also at Delhi at that time. There was a strong opposition of the mullahs. The edicts of the mullahs against the promised Messiah alayhi salam were published in the papers. Mulana Sahib became sad and thought that if someone claims to be a messenger of God and the leader of the spiritual world, then his claim should be examined under the light of the Holy Quran and Hadith. He felt that the mullahs were doing excess, which is against the norm of peaceful Islamic teachings. He felt that he should visit the promised Messiah and go and check for himself. When he arrived in Qadian and came across Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad al-Islam's illuminated countenance, his heart bore witness that this was not the face of a liar. He then exchanged some thoughts and views with him, and thereafter, being fully satisfied from all angles, he immediately took bayat at the promised Messiah al-Islam's hands. The year of birth is not exactly known, but it is thought to be in the latter part of 1905. So what a miracle, as I said, for a person to have come from Burma to have been by chance in the same city as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then to have taken the journey onto Qadian. After some time, Mulana Kabir Nur Sahib returned to his home in Chittagong and engaged himself in tabligh like a full-fledged soldier. He was the only Ahmadi in the whole of eastern Bengal at that time. He conducted lots of meetings and spread the news of the advent of the promised Messiah Islam. Immediately, opposition cropped up. Mullahs started agitating against him and tried to stop him many ways. But he continued to do tabligh resolutely and with a lot of debates with the ulamas. He would always fervently pray to Allah Almighty for guidance. He also regularly wrote to the Prophet Messiah Islam describing the tortures inflicted upon him and requested prayers for him. His letters and reports describing the oppositions were published in the Badr newspaper in Qadian in 1907. Nobody was there in Bengal with whom he could share his grief and affliction. Mawlana Kabir Nur Muhammad Sahib used to explain the death of Hazrat Isa alayhi salam elaborately. He wrote a book named Wafat-e Masih Maruf or Zulfikar Ali. After its publication, he became famous in the locality by the name of Isa Mara Molvi, which translates into the Molvi who killed Isa alayhi salam. Mawlana Ahmed Kabir Nur tirelessly and relentlessly continued to spread the word of Ahmadiyyat. However, it is not known whether anyone was blessed with the opportunity to convert to Ahmadiyyat through him. Very sadly, he would often tell his relatives, "Oh, my kith and kin, oh, villages, even after I explained so much to you, none of you accepted the truth. None of you had the good fortune of becoming a walker of Siratul Mustaqim. But remember this, Ahmadiyyat is Allah's established Jama'at. Its claim is that its truth is as clear as daylight, and that Ahmadiyyat will be victorious all over the world. After my death, members of the Ahmadiyyat Jama'at from far off places will come to my grave. Behave well with them. While the words are full of extreme pathos for those who did not accept the message, yet they are also undeniably clear in his belief of the triumph of the promised Messiah Islam and Ahmadiyyat, expressed with the certainty of knowledge of one who has experienced fire by putting his hand in fire. As a result, his descendants are following his instructions. They show respect to Ahmadis who visit and narrate tales of his glorious life as an Ahmadi with respect. The date and births of the death of Maulana Kabir Sahib are not known. However, when he died, his children were still young, and it is assumed that he died in between 1911 and 1912 in his mid-40s. This great devotee of the Imam Mahdi alayhi salam is buried at the family graveyard of Mohsin Aulia's descendants. Only his nephews can show you the actual location of the grave, since the custom is not to put nameplates, and they are shown, and his grave lies beneath the shade of a large tree. Moving on to Hazrat Raeesuddin Khan Sahib, who is the second Sahib of Bengal. He's from the village of Najargaon of Kishorganj district. He was blessed with the opportunity to visit Qadian in 1906 and took bayat at the hand of Hazrat Promised Messiah alayhi salam and became a Sahaba. His father's name was Nazimuddin Khan. Nazimuddin Khan Sahib was a pious and respected citizen. He gave the highest religious education to his children in their early days. It is said that Raeesuddin Khan Sahib studied in Mymensingh and Kolkata. In those days, educating boys, especially Muslim boys, was rare. The alim and the ulama had given the edict that learning English was wrong and against the Sharia. As a result, Muslim boys and girls did not go to school to study. In such a situation, schooling of Raeesuddin Khan Sahib lighted up Najargaon. He became well known for having an excellent character and being a pious man. All his relatives were proud of him and wished and prayed for him. After finishing his education, he joined the postal department and, after working different locations, was also posted in Myanmar or Burma as a postmaster. After the day's work, his interests were only in worship. He would be busy with fasting, prayers, and religious programs. Since childhood, Raeesuddin Khan Sahib was interested in reading books. He knew Bangla, English, Urdu, and Persian language, so he would read religious books and papers in different languages. He would be busy reading and researching the Holy Quran and Hadith for gaining knowledge and proficiency in Islamic literature. It was then that he came to know from an Urdu newspaper that a man of Qadian, of Punjab, claimed to be Imam Mahdi, and that he was, a liar according to the alim and ulama of the society. This raised an interest in him to find out the truth, because the Holy Quran and the Hadith have prophesied about the advent of the Hazrat Imam Mahdi at the beginning of the 14th century. Thus, the claim had to be checked, studying Islamic literature. However, Raeesuddin Khan Sahib was at a loss. He had no clue as how he was going to do so, so he continued to pray. Look how gloriously the prayers are answered by the unseen God. One day, during Jummah, in the town of Magui in Myanmar, where Raeesuddin Khan Sahib was posted, two people came into the mosque from the Punjab. One was a member of the armed forces, the other was an employee of the postal department. After the Jummah prayers, the two visitors wanted to speak to the devotees in the mosque about the truth and advent of the Imam Mahdi and distribute books and leaflets. At the beginning of those speeches, those in the mosque became agitated and insulted the two guests and forced them out of the mosque. Seeing this, Raeesuddin Khan Sahib became very upset. He knew that the members of the mosque did not act according to the teachings of Islam. Khan Sahib, according to the teaching of Islam, spoke politely to the two guests and invited them to his house. Thus, the two Sahabas went to Khan Sahib's house. For a long time, they intensely discussed the truth of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam. Khan Sahib, being a very pious man, immediately saw the undeniably clear signs of logic and the blessings of the Almighty. Before the two men left, they presented him an Urdu book of the Jama'at named Asle Musafa. After being introduced to the Dajjal while reading the book, he ultimately accepted the truth of Ahmadiyyat. His heart wanted to go to Qadian and accept the bayat at the hands of the Messiah. So he took leave and came to his home in Najagaon and told his elder brother the glad tidings of the advent of the Imam Mahdi alayhi salam, and requested him to accompany him to Qadian. His elder brother was also amazed after listening to the manifestation of God's signs. However, due to his poor health, could not accompany him. Raeesuddin Khan Sahib set out for Qadian alone, as I said, a distance of 1,500 miles, almost a distance from here to Los Angeles, from here to Chicago. There is no plane, no paved roads, only slow trains and horse-drawn carts. He went to Batala by train and then rode by horse to Qadian. When he reached Qadian and met Hazrat Masih Ma'ad alayhi salam, he was astonished by the countenance of his holy face and by hearing his pleasant voice. He was even more amazed when the Promised Messiah alayhi salam showed concern whether he had gotten hurt on his way to Qadian. He took bayat at the Promised Messiah's hands and stayed in Qadian for 15 days. Within this time, he learnt many things from the Promised Messiah and many of the other Sahabas. He also became a great soldier for Tabligh, gaining knowledge of the Holy Quran and Hadith. He returned to Myanmar and went back to his previous work routine. In 1910, Raeesuddin Khan Sahib's elder brother passed away, and his mother requested that he should return to Bengal. He did so after taking a year's leave, but when it was time for him to return, his mother reminded him that it was a greater duty of his to serve his parents, as that was what has been pointed out in the Quran and Hadith. And as an obedient son, he did so. He lived in his home to serve his aged mother, but along with this opportunity to serve his mother, Allah the Almighty also provided him the opportunity to show the lost Muslims of Bengal the right path through Tabligh. When Raeesuddin Khan Sahib took bayat, there was only one other Ahmadi in the whole of Bengal, and that was Maulana Kabir Noor Sahib that I've already mentioned. However, the two of them never met. The second Ahmadi was Hazrat Raeesuddin Khan Sahib himself, and the third was his wife, Hazrat Azizat Unnisa and Sahiba of the Sayyid family. From late November 1912, Mulana Abdul Wahid Sahab, the person who wrote the letters to the Promised Messiah Islam, started taking bayats in Brahminburiya. The Anjuman Ahmadiyyat was first established in Bengal in the presence of Mufti Muhammad Sadiq Sahab Raziyatanahu in Brahminburiya. All those people in various parts of Bengal to whom Khan Sahib had done tabligh all entered the fold of Ahmadiyyat. And Mulana Sayyid Abdul Wahid became the president. Raeesuddin Khan Sahib continued to do tabligh and held many debate sessions in his own home. These sessions were attended by many Maulvis. However, they eventually became greatly aggravated to the point that they filed a case against him at the local police station, stating that he held anti-government sessions at his home. The local police inspector went over to ask Raeesuddin Sahib whether the complaints were true. He said that he had only tried to prove the truth of Ahmadiyyat and Hazrat Masih Ma'ad alayhi salam's claim in the meeting he held at his place. He never gave any anti-government speeches. When the inspector said he saw he could not find any witnesses who could testify that Khan Sahib was lying, he realized that he was speaking the truth and wrote in his investigation that the villagers had a disagreement on religious matters. Khan Sahib passed away at midnight of September 1921 at the age of 56 or 58. Before his death, he told his wife that he should be buried in front of his house so that in the future people can come from very far off places to visit his grave. Presently, the graveyard remains well preserved. So I conclude with these two saintly and pious people, Hazrat Maulana Ahmad Kabir Noor Muhammad and Hazrat Raeesuddin Khan Sahib, were devout followers of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. By the Almighty Allah's grace, they had the opportunity to see the truth and the claim of the Promised Messiah Islam and take birth at his hands. Thus, they were privileged to get the exalted status of Sahabas of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam. There were two great men of Bengal whose life I have only put forward briefly. We hope and pray that the people of Bangladesh and all others are inspired by the lives of them, of their exemplary lives. In the end, I conclude with where I first started. In the final verses of Surah Al-Waqi'ah, Allah promises to those on the right hand, peace be on thee who is from those on the right hand. And Allah's promise to those who are the foremost is that for him is comfort and fragrance of happiness and a garden of bliss. May Allah's promise be fulfilled on these jewels of Bengal. Ameen.